You're watching India Fights, back with me, Rajat Kain. Well, in this edition of the show, we'll focus on the need to augment our vaccination chain. With the second phase of a COVID-19 vaccine already taking off, what is road ahead in context of a supply chain, network, and the cold storage capability? Well, the government has created large task force like NEGVAC, which stands for National Expert Group of Vaccine Administration for COVID-19. Now, this group comprised of block-level administrators, which are being overseen by the municipalities of a given state and, of course, their tehsils and municipal corporations in a given state or whatever mix they have. And this goes right up to the state principal secretary health and the chief secretary of a given state. Now, there has been a lot of thoughts and deliberations on the implementation, including sourcing and distribution, and finally the order of priority as to who gets the vaccine first. Now, keeping in mind this gigantic exercise, how are we going to balance out need for vaccination, both for domestic need, which is paramount, and of course, like our global supplies? Now, India of late has emerged one of the great global supplier of the vaccine. Well, to discuss further on this issue, we're joined with Professor N.K. Ganguly, former Director General, ICMR, and Dr. K. Madan Gopal, Senior Consultant, Health, NITI Aayog. Many thanks, gentlemen, for joining us. Let me start with you, Dr. Gopal. If we talk of a vaccination drive, given a population size and given requirement, of course, like we have gone into the process threadbare, how are we placed when it comes to supply chain for vaccine to the person who is last intended to use the vaccine?
Thank you, Rajat. It's very interesting, very important question, because in our previous discussions also, we have flagged that right now it's all supply driven. Whatever supplies are available, based on that, the groups are prioritized. Right. And based on the priorities, the vaccines have been rolled out. Mm-hmm. As and when the supply situation increases, because if you look at the way the vaccine has been designed to be rolled out in a phased manner. First phase was targeted to the for the healthcare workers and the frontline workers.
Right.
And the next phase is the 60 plus population and 45 and above with comorbid conditions. Mm-hmm. During the first phase, as happens elsewhere in the globe also, when the vaccine is undergoing the clinical trial, the stockpile of the vaccine happens. That means we have supplies every month, depending on the manufacturing capacities of the manufacturer, you have stockpile of the vaccine. So initial days when the vaccination drive happens, you can see a larger pace of vaccination. Hmm. And as the production is more or less, though efforts have been made to ramp up, but you have to see that we have to match the supplies and the way the vaccination is progressing. We have to match that. So initial, you have been able to comfortably cover the healthcare workers and the frontline workers. Now, as the vaccine supply improves, then we will be adding on to 50 years and it will be gradually open to the other groups as well. It's basically supply driven, and the efforts are being made to augment the manufacturing supply so that the supplies have been ensured, apart from meeting the domestic requirements as well as meeting the international commitments and other things. That's the way things are progressing. As of now, there is no shortage of vaccine, which has been reported. And the targeted population, the prioritized group, so we would be able to take care of them as the vaccination phase goes on.
Well, that's important, as you say, that there is no shortage in terms of supply. Dr. Ganguly, Professor Ganguly, I beg your pardon. Let me understand, or rather for the benefit of viewers, could we explain the mechanism of this particular vaccine for COVID-19? How different is it from the previous vaccination drive in terms of sheer logistics and cold chain transportation being something which is unique for this vaccine?
This vaccine has some uniqueness because this has got some defined platforms. These platforms have to need certain raw materials, amount of raw materials, as well as disposables like plastic tubings and many other things, and the scale in which this is being manufactured. Like previously, most vaccines were targeted for children. So we had 27 million births every year. So it was defined, and we could supply to other parts of the world. Supply of the raw material and supply chains were assured. This vaccine has a special needs. So what is happening now, that as Dr. Madan Gopal said, that we prioritized. The first phase, the vaccine take was 43% or 48%, somewhere in some places 56-57%, okay, because these were healthcare workers, these were a little cautious. Now in the second phase, when 60 and above and 45 and above with comorbidities have been taken, it has gone much faster, and now we have almost done 2 million in 24 hours. America promised 1 million, it went to 1.5 million per day, and now it has gone to 2 million per day. So we are, our catching up of this and the COVID app, we have taken care of. The supply chains, we have taken care of, that moving this except 4 or 5 states, we have been able to move the vaccines to every place. And we have taken a good strategy that mostly the hospitals, private and government hospitals, are delivering the vaccine. So the logistics of the vaccine delivery, we have taken care of. What we have not taken care of are 2 or 3 things. And we need to, like, because the majority of our supplies were coming from, raw material supplies were coming from United States.
Okay.
Because these are sophisticated media, reagents, and the disposable for the equipments. So US has created a Defense Act, Providers Act. In this act, you cannot access those sources anymore. Looks after itself. It doesn't look after the other part of the world in the current situation, because they are going through a very difficult situation. Mm-hmm. So that supply chain has been blocked. So we need to see from where do we access the supplies. Supplies in Europe are easier, but then in Europe also there is a huge vaccine shortage which is going on. So in the future, we will have to be prepared to really access the other things mostly. Now we need to, we may have to now prioritize certain groups differently, like about 6 or 7 states where we are having spikes. There are reason for that, like in Punjab because of Kisan Andolan, and some Gujarat because of this last cricket match, and some other places, some assemblies have happened and you see the spike. So we might have to really keep up other groups in these areas to stop transmission. Like one of the largest group which actually spreads transmission is 29 years and above. It is not in our scope at the moment. USA has included now teachers' vaccination so that they can open up the schools, because the teachers' union were very vocal that they will not open up the schools. So this will be one more priority. So our priority list might enlarge. The pregnant women data is now available. So it might go to pregnant women also in India. So our supplies are at the moment critical. One last point I will like to say, things are happening which never happened before. Like Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which will be done by BioE in India, is only one shot. And after 20 days, you are protected, as far as we know at this given moment. So this will be done by BioE. We need to see whether they have supplies of raw material or not. And the second thing, that J&J has gone with the Merck and Glaxo and using their facilities to enhance the production. And we need to see that whether we can do it in our country or not, because there is one more Sanofi facility in Hyderabad. Sanofi at the moment is not really producing it. So, we could see that whether we could get some agreement between the companies to enhance the production so that our supplies can meet, as Dr. Madan Gopal said, that we were cautious. We actually identified how much supplies we have and what are our priorities, and we went. But priorities will change.
Professor Ganguly, just stay on. I'll continue with this very important point as you're flagging. Let me just have a little response from Dr. Madan Gopal. Are there issues of supply that needs to be addressed at this stage? Or are you fairly confident that, we have enough of stock reserves? Why I'm asking this question is that Serum Institute of India has sought center government's intervention as per the reports in terms of imports from US.
And that's true, because as Professor Ganguly sir has already pointed out, saying that the raw materials and the invocation of this Defense Act by US, because they want to first prioritize their own manufacturing, then they will be supplying to the others. That would be one area, but I think diplomatically our country would be able to take up this issue, because SII vaccine is the sole vaccine for the COVAX facility as well, because one of the major supplies of the vaccine is coming to the COVAX facility is coming from Serum Institute. So hampering the supply would be hampering the vaccine supply to the rest of the world also. And it is not going to hamper for the coming 2-3 months. I think some solution would be found to this area. And at the DA level and the other level, I think they would be taking up at the to come across a solution to this. Apart from that, I think the co-vaccine and whether they are indigenous, some of the raw materials which are to be there, the Department of Pharma would be very much on the help of FAS and addressing this issue, because at this moment, when the vaccination drive has started, which is one of the tools for pandemic control, and it has created a lot of euphoria and going shortage of vaccine, I think everybody is now working, seeing that these shortages doesn't happen. And as of now, there are no shortages. But if the situation of the raw material persists like this, as mentioned by Mr. The CEO of SII, I think some corrective actions are to be taken. Otherwise, in the coming days, after 2 months, I think we would be having this problem. But I'm very optimistic that this problem will not be occurring, because whole of the world is looking at India as a biggest manufacturer and the biggest supplier of the vaccine in the coming days.
Right. Well, just stay on the thought, Dr. Madan Gopal, because and then we'll discuss next on we have to discuss about the balancing act of India versus our own domestic requirement along with world, which is expecting a lot from us. Professor Ganguly, you mentioned about how the in terms of supplies, there are some challenges that need to be addressed. Along with that, you are also listing out certain target group that should be in the priority. Please carry on, sir, because that seems to be fairly important here.
So in the drugs area, we knew that it might happen, because USA first looks after itself and it is in a very big mess at this given moment, although the infection is now coming down and plateauing in except in some states. So it normally does these kind of things. Like there was a very vital drug, Betaseron, which was needed by the entire world, but they were producing just enough for US. They didn't allow its supply outside. The Remdesivir, they knew that Gilead knew that it will not be able to export the US production, because US production, US need was very high at one given moment. So it gave open licenses to India. So India was also vulnerable for its API from China. So, so pharmaceutical ministry and others created a list of APIs where we were 100% dependent on China and encouraged Indian companies to make those APIs and supported them. So we should take a lesson out of this. These we had high media and some media companies in India which make raw material and other things. But we need to now take a lesson that in future we might become vulnerable. And government should now enhance the production of raw material, quality raw material in India, so that we are not dependent on others. Secondly, we need to really map. Our only thing we have promised and the global leadership has promised that we will give our part of our produce to the co-vaccine vaccine program of the Gavi, that is WHO. Med supply, which has promised 20% of supply from the end of 2020, 21 to the vulnerable countries.
Okay.
We are committed, but we need to see how much we will give to others after meeting our needs. And our need, I think our need will be to quickly immunize up to 70% of our population, or at least 60% of our population, so that the transmission stops in India and we can breathe well. The CDC has come out. One of the good thing about vaccine is now the CDC has today come out with that those who have been vaccinated, what they can do and how much precaution they can take and what they can't do. So in this fashion, there are a lot of things which will open up. Families will get united, families will get better, the businesses will get better. The travel, they have not at this given moment given clearance, but it might get better. So at this given moment, what I will suggest that we should take the USA has immunized 10% of its population. The Israel has immunized 25% of its population. If you see that how much population we have been able to immunize, we have to set priorities because of our production at this given moment. Very, very soon, another by the June, at least three more vaccines will be available to India. So we have set up a group. It should map that how we will use those productions and how we will immunize at least 60 to 70% of our population as quickly as possible so that we return to our normal life and normal activities.
Right. Absolutely. Dr. Madan Gopal, in terms of the Balancing Act, as Professor Ganguly also mentioned, our own domestic requirement vis-a-vis the expectations of world and several countries which are having from India, how are we going to balance it in near future?
As per my information, the already a high level committee is there, which is keeping a track of the production as well as the requirement. The Department of Pharma and the Department of Health and Family Welfare, I think they are having a committee. And they are monitoring the production, the requirements, and the international commitments and other things. That kind of balancing act is happening. And another thing is, initially, when we have discussed earlier, initial thought was to include 50 plus population. Now, as the vaccine supply improves, that 50 plus population will come, and the question of having the other categories would be more or less resolved. Because right now, we are seeing that how the things move, because it was a new vaccine, and we have to have an adverse event for falling immunization surveillance system in place. Now, having said that, now with the system and as the things have progressed, we are now having experience of inoculating more than 2 crores vaccinations. Now, having that information, now we can go at a very faster speed.
Okay.
And if you look at the urban and the rural thing, the uptake of the vaccine is higher in the urban areas. In the rural areas, still the uptake is not significantly higher. Now we have to see that how that requirement is also fulfilled. As the things are progressing, as new vaccines are added on, till now we are having only 2 vaccine candidates who have been put into service. We are expecting one more in the coming days. And if the nasal vaccine, which is under trials, which comes in, that would be a game changer for the whole of the world.
Absolutely. That is something which we have discussed earlier as well, nasal vaccine, and of course, like how it will be a game changer considering the logistics. Dr. Madan Gopal, just one small question here. In terms of, nasal vaccine, you mentioned that it will be a game changer, and we have one more vaccine that would be coming in some days to say off. Now, some states, as we speak, some states have been flagging this issue of some shortage in supply. So, how are we going to look forward with that?
It's not the shortage, it's the logistics management. Because they have been insisting that they want to. But more or less, whatever the registration is there on the COVID app, the logistics are being deployed as per the requirements of the, as per the registered population there. So if they are expressing, that means there is something, a mismatch between them. That needs to be looked at. see what mismatch is there. Otherwise, allocation to all the states is happening on a constant and as per the demand raised by the states only. So it is, right. It do happens through the COVID app, and based on the registered population and the requirement, the vaccines are being pushed to the states. And
right,
based on
right,
that,
right.
And suppose a state has been given up, there are two candidates. Some of the state, they insist that I want only one type of vaccine. Then it's become a very difficult situation.
Absolutely.
Otherwise, absolutely. Other states receiving both the vaccines, they don't have any much problem. But if a state is insisting that I should be having only one candidate of vaccine, then it's a very difficult proposition. That kind of things are happening, and they do would be happening because in the urban areas, you can find the system should be stressed out because the uptake of the vaccine is very high in the urban areas. But if the logistics from, if the in the rural area, if the things are not happening, if they can plan as per the requirement, I think that this problem can be handled.
Right. Professor Ganguly, like just as Dr. Madan Gopal mentioned, and we have discussed this earlier as well, in terms of vaccination, nasal vaccine, like I know it's little off the topic, but considering our supplies and of course requirement in days to come, how do you see nasal vaccine filling up whatever gap which possibly we might see in supply, and how you think it will be a game changer? Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I agree with that. Actually, I was responsible for doing a trial on measles intranasal vaccine because it is an injectable vaccine. So, but there are huge number of issues there because when you put the vaccine under pressure in the nose, there are small pores which go to the brain. So you have to do a very strong monkey protection studies. The device itself needs a lot of things, and there are a lot of other issues. And intranasal insulin, you know, created some major issues and problem. So I will take this as an advanced third generation vaccine, but I will not at the moment put high hopes that within the next 2 years, nasal vaccine will actually be used in our country. At the moment, no nasal vaccine per se, although Mexico, etc., have used measles nasals, but at the moment, it is not globally there. But other vaccines are all working well. There's no vaccine which is not working well at this given moment. Some are protecting more or less, but everyone is protecting from death. Everyone is protecting from hospitalization. Most right. vaccines are safe at this given moment. So right. we at this given moment will be happy with the 6 or 7 vaccines which will be available to us. So I will be very happy with that. Only thing is that one more issue I will like to flag, that we need to really map those vulnerable populations who are not getting it, even in the urban areas. Is urban slum dwellers are getting vaccinated, like those in the Dharavi. There has been a peak in, again, Dharavi was almost zero. Then again, there has been a peak. Are they getting vaccine adequately? Are our tribal population in Odisha, Madhya Pradesh and others who live in the areas, dense areas, are they getting it? I will do a mapping. I will also do a mapping for migrating population. Huge amount of population in India every year migrate because of livelihood and others. Finally, if I have 5 or 6 vaccine, I will give a choice in the private market for those who, so whatever vaccine they want, they can take, but they need to pay more. And a part of that money should be used to provide vaccine to our larger vulnerable population who may not be able to pay.
Right. So
one of the issues we need to take, that even if you cannot pay, you are not capable of paying, you get the vaccine.
Right, Professor Ganguly, right, point well taken. Dr. Madan Gopal, would like to respond to it, like in vaccination regarding the vulnerable group before we wind up the show?
Yes, I agree with Professor Ganguly, because we have been discussing and deliberating on this issue, how to provide equity in vaccination. Because as you look at the uptake of the vaccine, the people who are tech savvy and others, they are registering themselves and they are availing the services. The uptake in the rural areas is poor. It's not that. including the tribal areas. We have to see that the conventional way of giving a jab to this population, we have to go. That means the outreach immunizations, we have to plan for that. The migratory population and the people who are living in slum site, we have to prioritize them, because they can act as potential super spreader in the community if they have been left behind.
Right.
So, yeah, that is, that discussion is very much there. And I think in the coming days, you will be seeing that how the uptake happens in the rural areas and then the tribal areas. That is going.
Right, Dr. Madan Gopal. Many thanks for joining us and throwing light upon this extremely important issue of supply chain. Of course, like also if there are any gaps and how they'll be addressed. Many thanks, Professor Ganguly. But before we leave, a small appeal to all our viewers. Please take care of yourself. The pandemic is not over yet. Keep following small COVID appropriate behavior like wearing of masks, washing your hands, and also don't forget to maintain the physical distancing. Remember, these are small things that can help us in defeating this pandemic. Well, that's it in this edition of India Fights Back. Thanks for watching Sunset TV. Goodbye.